I'm very concerned about this. And of course, the way you can get people into Arkansas and the frontier regions in the 19th century is farming. Got to get farmers in to develop land first. You can't just have to throw down a Walmart store and say, it's a town to grow up around. So in 1803, the United States government created the Board of Land Commissioners for the Louisiana Territory. The Board of Land Commissioners would be deciding all cases regarding any kind of land claims in all Louisiana purchase, or the Louisiana Territory. They take evidence of various claims and try to judge their validity. Now, one of the big problems of the frontier era was fraudulent land claims. People very easily forged signatures, forged documents, and no one really knew one way or another whether the sale was legitimate or not. Pretty speaking paper, somebody's signature on it saying, well, yes, I have a receipt for this land right here. Don't you believe it? And of course, that wouldn't absolutely be true. Absolutely not true at all. And the Board of Land Commissioners was designed to try to ferret out what is a legitimate claim, what is a fraudulent claim. If you're caught with a counterfeit land claim, you can go to jail for a very long period of time. One of the earliest problems of the Board of Land Commissioners was what to do with any of these Spanish land claims, some being transferred to Americans, competing land claims here and there because the land is so very poorly surveyed. So by 1812, 9 years of service, they accepted 1,340 claims. Probably about one out of every three claims from all of Missouri and Arkansas coast. In fact, one of the commissioners, a man named Frederick Bates, he hears appeals on some of these land claims from 1816. Appeal amounting about 1,750 claims, 145 being in Arkansas. Now, a third of these claims turned out to be on Spanish grants and 100 of them on existing settlements. And it took years basically to try to sort all these things out. People claiming land here and there and everywhere else. Hundreds, sometimes even thousands of cases. Because even if you had a piece of paper in your hand saying you own this piece of land, that was not a guarantee that you owned it. So until the Board of Land Commissioners formally said, this is your land, it wasn't really yours. Well, there was no guarantee it was really yours. That's why at this time, throughout the whole frontier, a preference is given to a pre-existing settlement called a setter rights. That essentially, if you were living there already, that gave you a stronger claim on the land than just simply a piece of paper saying, well, I bought this land, I'm trying to sell it for some speculation or business purposes, or planning on retiring or whatever. Of course, it wouldn't actually be retiring in the 19th century, but whatever kind of excuse you made for it. Now, once a lot of these land claims are kind of sorted out, federal government decides to use Arkansas to make good on a few debts. Now, in the first 40, 50 years of American history, the United States was not a tremendous economic powerhouse. We're a very indebted nation. Economy still kind of weak, very agricultural. But it's trying to develop, particularly the industrial sectors in the Northeast. The agricultural sector is trying to develop more infrastructure coming in, more of the economy starting to develop a little bit more. The United States government itself had very little money, very little cash on hand, to actually pay off its debts. What it did have, though, was a lot of land, so it used this large amounts of land to pay these debts. Now, particularly to war veterans. The American Revolution, a lot of land in Ohio and the Northwest Territories given to Revolutionary War veterans. Essentially, they were promised a certain amount of money or a bonus for land for their service in the war. And so this land was given to them. And same kind of offers made for the War of 1812. Anyone to sign up for the fight for the United States in the War of 1812 will be given land. Basically, they would call it military bounty. So for any individual to sign up for War of 1812, any man would say, he would receive 160 acres of land. Not a bad deal. Especially when you consider that federal land sales at this point went for about a dollar an acre. You say $160 is kind of the usual kind of practice that these lands are sold on is a lot more money than most settlers had at the time. And by the time of farming is done here in Arkansas in the eastern part of the United States, if you have about 20 acres of vegetation planted, that's usually enough to feed you and your family. The rest grown for profit or to rotate fields, sell, or do whatever you want with it. So it's a fairly sufficient size for farming. And so after the War of 1812, the United States owes about 6 million acres. Not just to enlistees, but also to people who loaned the United States government a lot of money during the war. So the government decides to pay off some of this with about 2 million acres in Arkansas. In 1816, a series of surveying expeditions were taken. And so in 1818, the land value is to be distributed. But unfortunately, though, Arkansas's luck creeps up again. There was a lot of very rich farmland in Arkansas, very highly productive. Not a lot of people wanted to come out to Arkansas. Very few veterans actually came to the advantage of the land grants that were made available to them. And most of the lands were made available to veterans were sold to speculators. Basically, people trying to make money on the real estate. So Arkansas did not see a lot of growth because of that. But before long, the territory realized that there were enough people in the territory and enough people farming and enough lands that the territory could start paying some bills through a land taxation. So in 1823, the first property taxes are invoked on lands. And those who could not sell the taxes would have their property seized and the property sold at auctions. In fact, for a long period of time, the Arkansas Gazette, which at that time was the only newspaper in Arkansas, there would be huge listings all the time of various land auctions. Who has to pay their taxes and what land is. They say if such and such owes $40, hasn't paid it, we're auctioning it off. The first of these auctions takes place in 1824, and the territory is only able to recoup just a fraction of the money that was owed to it. But as the territory period comes to an end by the late 1830s, the Arkansas Land Office was sold about a million acres. Population was growing, but it was fairly paltry compared to neighboring states and territories. I'll give you a couple statistics here.
Canada was
By 1830, there were about 30,000 people living in the territory. Statehood in 1836 or 1840, Arkansas had a population of 98,000. It's 1.9 people per square mile. And Missouri this time had about 5 or 6 people per square mile. Of Mississippi, 4. Louisiana, about 5 people per square mile. Very lightly populated compared to neighboring areas. By 1850, population of 210,000. Considerable improvement, but still only 8.3 people per square mile. Again, far below its neighbors. So Arkansas starts growing, starts picking up, but still way behind its neighbors. It always has problems in catching up. But Arkansas is a fairly young state, fairly young territory. Young men looking for adventure would make their way out here. By the, according to the 1840 census, 47% of adult men in Arkansas were in their 20s. Apparently very young group of men in the state. That's compared to 40% nationwide. So they have a state and a territory full of very young, very ambitious men. Kind of ambitions be clashing and marking a very colorful period in the state's history. All right, we'll go ahead and take a break on that point. So are there any questions on anything so far? All right, let's take a break. So the period of the territory is a fairly interesting. But one big name to know is Robert Crittenden. Do He is the first territorial secretary of Arkansas. Basically, whatever the judges and the governor didn't do, he did everything else. Great to do with a passion. And territorial secretary from 1819 to 1829, 10 years. Came to Arkansas with a fairly good reputation. He's 22 years old, very young man, very able, very talented. He's a brother of Senator John J. Crittenden of Kentucky. He has a lot of connections. Thanks to his brotherhood, in the days before the Civil War, coming up with the Crittenden Compromise, kind of last-ditch effort to try to save the Union. Didn't work. And Crittenden, of course, had what was considered to be one of the main pedigrees of successful frontier politicians. He was an Indian fighter. He had fought several skirmishes and wars with different Native American groups. That time seemed to be very important to the frontier public. Say, Crittenden's appointment as territorial secretary arrives as soon as he can in Arkansas. But since Miller hasn't arrived yet, he won't for several months, Crittenden takes it upon himself to act as acting governor of Arkansas. It's basically until these federal judges Miller arrives, Crittenden is the government. Takes upon himself to make several decisions on policy and appointments, which kind of irritates Miller a little bit when he arrives, but what's done is done. Crittenden appointed circuit judges, attorneys, auditors, treasurers, sheriffs, coroners, clerks for each of the five counties in 1819. This is even for the county positions. They still weren't yet elected positions. They were at this point just getting started for appointed positions. And Miller sat in these positions without the men friendly to him, political outlaws. Say, circuit judge, county attorney, auditor, and so forth. So I don't know why there's such a big fight over the corner division, but it's there. So in October of 1819, the one major elected position that is available is territorial delegate. See, territorial delegate, that is essentially Arkansas's voice in Congress. Territorial delegate is a non-voting member of Congress. They can speak on various issues, but they cannot vote on any legislation. Arkansas is a statewide position, a territorial-wide position, I'd say. There are a couple number of delegates in the House of Representatives today. Say only the House of Representatives, none in the Senate. For example, the District of Columbia have a non-voting delegate, Donna Holmes North has a delegate, Guam has a delegate, Virgin Islands has a non-voting delegate, a number of others. Well, Crittenden wants to make sure that one of his key allies gets this position. And Crittenden also decides that it's time to start holding elections for the territorial legislature. So they can start forming one. The big election here is territorial delegates. This election is held, but Crittenden doesn't exactly do this by the book. He has to report the existence of the election results of the U.S. Secretary of State, which was required to do at that time was John Quincy Adams, until July 1820. The entire year has passed. Winner of the territorial delegate election is Crittenden's handpicked candidate, James Woodson Bates. Our first territorial delegate. Jason Bates. Bates has his own connections. He is the brother of the territorial secretary of Missouri. And Bates will be reelected in 1821. Well, Bates serves very modestly, but Crittenden really isn't satisfied with Bates. It's kind of a falling out. So in 1823, Crittenden turns to Henry W. Connell. Conway and his very large extended family. Conway is a War of 1812 veteran. He's from Tennessee, well connected himself. And the Conways and their family would have come to dominate the early politics of Arkansas until the Civil War period. Several members of the legislature, governors, members of Congress, many of them, Conways themselves, are very closely related. That group of cousins, Sevier, very closely connected and worked very closely together. Anyways, Henry Conway, his uncle was a man named William Rector, who was the Surveyor General of Illinois. Surveyor General for Illinois, Missouri, and Arkansas. The thing about Surveyor General is he is basically the one who okays all land surveys. Basically, if you want your land okayed, or you want it a little bigger, your neighbors a little smaller, he was the one to take one to talk to. Which made Conway a very important man. That city, Conway, Conway County, all named after Conways. Henry's younger brother, James Sevier Conway, being the first governor of the state of Arkansas in 1836. Arkansas's first U.S. Senator, Ambrose Sevier, was the first U.S. Senator of 1836-1848. And of course, later on there would be a governor Rector, who was a cousin of both. Conways and Sevier's. Henry Conway proved to be very popular and very quickly outshining Robert Crittenden, much to Crittenden's shock and horror. Which meant that very quickly Conway no longer needed Crittenden, which they very quickly became political adversaries. But a lot of some Conway's early confidence from the people comes from the removal of the Quapaw from the territory in 1824, you can see from this map standing up here. As you can see, this is a later land cession for the territorial period. The Cherokee territory here in the northwestern part of the state was a seat of the U.S. government. Cherokee's moving into the Indian Territory. Choctaw lands, a seat of the two parts, 1820-25. Quapaw lands, basically right here, seat of the U.S. in 1824. What is now Miller County was briefly made a Caddo Reserve in 1835, before being finally kicked out of that region as well. Now, in the meantime, a few other developments are taking place at the top of Arkansas government. James Miller, the somewhat absentee governor, the territorial governor, resigned in 1825, which means now there's an opening for a territorial governor. Crittenden sees this big chance. It's a chance to move ahead, really make a name for himself, and give himself kind of an official position instead of just kind of doing the work, all the work behind the scenes. Crittenden's really pushing to become a territorial governor. But instead, President Monroe chooses George Iser. George Iser is from South Carolina, planter, another War of 1812 general. Iser be territorial governor from 1825 to 1828. Crittenden is bitterly disappointed, really crushed by it. Immediately decides at the beginning he's not going to like Iser, do everything he can to get rid of him. So Iser and Crittenden clash constantly all from the beginning. And so because of this, Iser doesn't like Crittenden. Conway doesn't think too much of him. He hasn't really openly broken with him yet, but he doesn't think too much of Crittenden. So Iser and Conway start to get to talking and decide to, you know, they have a lot in common to form a political alliance against Crittenden. At this point, Crittenden decides he's going to get rid of Conway. If he has enough allies left, he thinks he can do it. So Crittenden turns to Robert C. Oden as a candidate for territorial delegate in 1827. Inscribed in the book is Talented but Erratic. There's an election. This is Crittenden's candidate for territorial delegate. Henry Conway is running for re-election for his third term. Now, during the election, some rather scurrilous charges are brought by Oden up about Conway, essentially saying that Conway was on the take. There's a charge was that Conway spent $600 out of $7,000 entrusted by Congress for him to bring to Little Rock.